So in the last class, we have discussed about the common emitter amplifier, and we have also calculated the gain of the amplifier, having considered two different configurations. One is associating emitter resistance with the emitter terminal, and the second one was there was no resistance. That means this emitter terminal was directly connected to ground. And we have also seen that whenever we make any attempt to connect the resistor, I mean emitter resistor, with the emitter terminal, then the gain value, the voltage gain value, drops significantly. But at the same time, it provides a good stability. So that's why we cannot get rid of this emitter resistance connected through the emitter terminal. But to enhance the gain, the small signal voltage gain, what we have done is we have also connected one bypass capacitor in shunt with the emitter resistance, so that this small signal current will pass through this bypass capacitor, bypassing the emitter resistance. And as a matter of fact, in the small signal equivalent circuit of the BJT amplifier, we don't have the provision of this emitter resistance. And in the last class, we have also identified what is the difference between the AC load line and DC load line in connection to the common emitter amplifier circuit with the emitter resistance, either bypassed or unbypassed. Now today, we will be discussing about the other two configurations of BJT amplifier. So during the initial discussion, I have already mentioned that there could have been three different possibilities. I mean, there could have been three different configurations depending upon the input terminal and the output terminal. As you know, BJT is a three-terminal device. I mean, this base, emitter, and the collector. So depending upon the terminal at which you are applying the input, so there could have been three different configuration. So far, we have discussed about the common emitter configuration, in which case the emitter terminal was common to both the input and as well as to the output. So for common emitter amplifier, the input was applied between the base and emitter, and the output was obtained between the collector and the emitter. Now today, initially we will start with the common collector configuration. So in case of common collector configuration, we must understand that the collector is common to both the input as well as to the output. So let us start with a fundamental circuit of common collector. So we are considering this voltage divider kind of bias, R1 and R2. Now the base is connected over here. Now this is the collector terminal of the transistor. This is the emitter terminal. Now the collector terminal is common to both the input and to the output. So during the construction of this AC equivalent circuit or small signal equivalent circuit, this collector terminal is considered to be at AC ground. That means the potential at this terminal is considered to be constant, a DC potential over here. So instead of having any collector resistance, we are connecting it directly to the collector terminal, so that this collector potential is throughout constant, irrespective of the value of the input signal. And this is the supply line, so VCC. So collector potential is always held at a constant potential of VCC. For VCC equal to 5 volt, it will be constant at 5 volt. VCC equal to 6 volt, it will be constant at 6 volt, and so on. So since that potential is always constant, irrespective of the value of the input signal, so I may consider that this potential is at AC ground, because the DC potential is constant. I mean, the total potential is constant. Now we have an emitter resistance over here, which essentially serves as the load resistance. This is RE, and we are taking the output from this terminal. And similarly, we need to apply the input at the base terminal through this coupling capacitor. We have a small signal source over here, VS. This is the coupling capacitor, CC. So one change we have noticed over here, depending upon the point at which we're taking the output. So for common emitter configuration, the collector resistance was connected over here, and we are taking the output from this terminal, that means from the collector terminal. So for common emitter configuration, base to emitter was the input terminal and collector to emitter was the output terminal. Now here, for common collector configuration, this collector is held at a constant DC potential. That means that it is at AC ground. So we are applying the input between base to AC ground, that means base to collector, and we are obtaining the output between the emitter terminal to the collector terminal, that means from emitter to ground. So this particular configuration is known to be a common collector configuration. Now, having drawn the circuit of this particular configuration, let us first try to understand or try to draw the small signal equivalent circuit so that we can calculate the voltage gain pertaining to this particular amplifier. So to draw the equivalent circuit, first of all, we need to identify this resistance R pi, which is connected between the base and the emitter terminal. So this is the base terminal. This is the emitter terminal. Now between these two, we have connected this R pi. Now here, emitter is not connected to ground. Rather, it is connected to ground through the resistance Re. So this is the resistance Re through which it is connected to AC ground. Now we are drawing the small signal equivalent circuit. So all this ground potential refers to the AC ground, a small signal ground. So as you understand, this is the emitter terminal. So already we have drawn this R pi and Re. Now, if I observe these two resistances R1 and R2, we will see that both of them are connected between base to ground, base to AC ground, R2 from base to this point, and R1 is from base to VCC. So VCC is at AC ground. So both of these two resistances, R1 and R2, they are connected in shunt in the AC equivalent circuit between base to ground. So this resistance is R1 parallel R2. Now we are applying the input signal over here. So for small signal equivalent circuit, we can safely ignore this coupling capacitor, assuming that it provides a very negligible reactance at the signal frequency, so that I can consider that this acts essentially as a short circuit. But if the signal source is not ideal, so in that case, we have to incorporate the corresponding source resistance. So this is the small signal source over here, Vs, which is connected between base to ground and through some series resistance Rs, which is typically pretty small, in the order of few tens of ohms. Now this completes the drawing in the input side. Now in the output side, between collector to emitter, we have this source GM V pi, current source. So this is the emitter terminal, this is the collector terminal. So between collector to emitter, we have GM times V pi, or beta times IB, the same thing. If I follow the pi model, then it will be like GM times V pi. If I follow the hybrid model, then it will be beta times IB. So this is the collector terminal, and collector is held at AC ground. So this terminal is grounded, and you know that between collector to emitter, we have this R0. This is also connected between collector to emitter. R0 is connected, which is nothing but the output resistance. So if you wish, you can connect this one just like this. Sorry. Let me change this one. So this is GM times V pi. This is at ground. Now collector to emitter. So collector is already at AC ground. This is R naught. This is Gm times V pi or beta times Ib, same thing. This is the base terminal. This is the emitter terminal. This is the collector terminal. Collector is at constant DC potential. So that's why it is at AC ground. And between base to emitter, we have this R pi, and the corresponding voltage drop is regarded as V pi over here. Now between collector to emitter, we have Gm times V pi, this current source, which is also equivalent to beta times Ib as far as the H parameter model is concerned. Collector is at AC ground. Emitter terminal is connected to ground through Re, resistance Re. And R naught, this output resistance, is connected between the collector terminal to the emitter terminal. Now, since the emitter is collector is already connected to AC ground, so I can always safely connect this R naught between emitter to AC ground. So now we can also make this collector terminal the bottom side so that it looks like perfectly a two-port network, and it will help us to analyze the circuit in a much more elegant way. So I'm redrawing the same circuit. So this is the collector terminal. So we have started with R1 parallel R2. This is the base terminal. Now we have this R pi resistance between base to emitter. R pi is connected between base to emitter. So this is the emitter terminal. This is the collector terminal. This terminal is the collector terminal. So that's why it is at AC ground. So between emitter to collector, we have this Gm V pi. So just try to understand the direction of this current source from collector to emitter. So this is the collector terminal. So that's why this is the direction of Gm times V pi. And we have these two resistances between emitter to ground. One is Re, second one is R naught. So this potential is at AC ground. This potential is also at AC ground. This potential is also at AC ground. So I can always connect them together. I can connect them together. And we have the input signal. This is RS. And VS over here. So output is taken from this particular terminal, V naught. So this is the collector terminal. So this is at AC ground. So I have actually drawn the same circuit in an elegant way so that you can relate it with the input-output port model of any amplifier. So R1 and R2, these two resistances are in parallel. So between base to collector, we have these two resistances, R1 and R2. And from base to emitter, we have this R pi, this resistance R pi. Between collector to emitter, we have Gm V pi. Note down the direction of this current source. And obviously, while writing this one, so this terminal is positive with respect to this, and the potential difference is regarded as V pi. We have two other resistances, Re, emitter resistance, which is basically acting like an output resistance over here, the load resistance over here, this Re, emitter resistance. And the output resistance of the transistor itself, R naught, is connected between the collector to the emitter, so between emitter to the AC ground, because collector is at AC ground, and this is the output voltage. I don't know whether this can be drawn. I mean, this can be selected, this entire thing. No, it is not possible to select the entire thing. So to analyze, I need to redraw the same circuit once again. So let me very quickly draw the circuit. The same circuit I'm just quickly drawing. So that we can calculate the expression for the voltage gain. So the same thing, this is R1 parallel R2, this is R pi, this is Gm times V pi, this is Rd, this is R0. We are taking the output from this terminal V0, this is Vs, this one is the source resistance Rs. You can already identify the three terminals. These are the three terminals. This one is the base terminal, this one is the emitter terminal, and this one is the collector terminal, which is essentially at DC ground, AC ground. So you have to identify the, or you have to calculate the gain expression AV, which is nothing but V0 upon Vs. Vs is the input signal which you apply over here, and V0 is the output signal which you are getting at the emitter terminal. So the ratio of these two is given by V0 by Vs, which is nothing but the voltage gain of common collector configuration. Now to find out this voltage gain, let us try to identify few other elements which will help us in understanding or calculating the expression for the voltage gain. Suppose looking at this terminal, for example, already you have identified that this is the voltage V pi. V pi is this voltage between base to emitter, with base, which is nothing but the base potential with respect to the emitter potential. And accordingly, we have this Gm times V pi over here. Now assume that potential at base with respect to ground is given by V in. This potential is V in. Potential at base with respect to emitter is V pi. Potential at base with respect to ground or with respect to collector is V in. And suppose looking at this terminal, the resistance offered by the amplifier itself, looking at this terminal, this resistance, suppose this is given by RIB. Looking at the base, what is the resistance? That is RIB, for example. So if I just identify that the current being drawn over here is IB, through the base terminal, the current that will flow is IB, this current. And here, the applied potential, or here the available potential, is V in between base to ground. So RIB can be represented as, between these two terminals, what is available voltage? V in. And what is the current being drawn? The current is nothing but IB. So V in by IB is nothing but RIB. Now we have to calculate what is the expression for V in. So I can write V in as small signal voltage V in between base to ground. That is equal to the current that is flowing through this R pi is IB. And over here, this IB and this current is Gm times V pi, which is nothing but beta times IB. So here the total current IO, if I consider this total current IO, is nothing but 1 plus beta times IB. IB base current plus this current, beta times IB, so 1 plus beta times IB. And what is the effective resistance over here? We have two resistances connected in shunt, RE and R0. So the effective resistance over here is R0 parallel RE. So I can write V in is equal to the potential drop, voltage drop across this base to emitter and emitter to ground. So V in is equal to the potential at base with respect to ground, which can be written like this: potential between base to emitter and plus the potential between emitter to ground. So this is equal to IB times R pi plus 1 plus beta times IB into RE parallel R0. So from this, we can deduce the expression for RIB, which is nothing but V in by IB. This is equal to R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE parallel R0. So this is the effective resistance looking at the base. Now here, for common collector configuration, base is the input terminal. So here the Effective input resistance provided by this common collector configuration is given by R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re parallel R naught. If you just remember, the input resistance provided by a common emitter amplifier, it was like R pi only. For common emitter amplifier, where the input was applied between base to emitter, the effective input resistance was essentially governed by R pi. But here, the effective resistance is governed by R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re parallel R naught. Now, if I just consider this one, Re parallel R naught, so out of these two resistances, since these are connected in shunt, so the lower value will dominate the effective or equivalent resistance. So Re and R naught, as you know, R naught is typically very large with respect to Re. Re is normally in the range of few kilo ohms or tens of kilo ohms, whereas R naught is in the order of few hundreds of kilo ohms. So the effective resistance or equivalent resistance is basically governed by Re. So I can approximate this expression like R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re. So there is a corresponding enhancement in the resistance because of this 1 plus beta. And this particular rule is known as resistance reflection rule. So here for common collector configuration, you have seen that the effective input resistance has been increased. For common emitter configuration, it was like only R pi. And here for common collector configuration, the effective resistance, input impedance is given by R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re. So typically very large. So for common emitter configuration, if the input resistance is in the order of few kilo ohms, so here it will be in the order of few hundreds of kilo ohms because of the presence of this beta. So that is all about the RIB. Now, if I think that the resistance looking at this point before R1 parallel R2, if that resistance is RI, if that resistance is RI, then it is quite obvious that RI is nothing but R1 parallel R2 parallel RIB. Because while calculating RIB, we have not considered R1 parallel R2. Now, if I take this R1 parallel R2 combination into our account, and if that resistance is regarded as Ri, then this Ri can be written like this, R1 parallel R2, and we have another equivalent resistance RIB. So R1 parallel R2 parallel RIB. This is all about Ri. Now, you can, given Ri, you can now redraw the input circuit like this. We have connection like this. Ri, effective resistance over here. We have Rs over here. And we have VS over here. This is VS. And this potential is Vin across base to ground. This difference, potential difference is Vin. So now, using the voltage divider rule, we can easily find Vin is equal to VS upon RS plus RI multiplied with RI. So that is equal to, let me write down the complete expression, R1 parallel R2 parallel RIB upon RS plus R1 parallel R2 parallel RIB multiplied with VS. As you can understand that this R1, R2, RIB, these are typically very large with respect to RS. So as a matter of fact, this inter ratio is very much close to 1. In case RS is 0, so obviously it will be 1. But in case RS is non-zero, but like a few tens of ohms, like 50 ohms or so, with respect to this 2 kilo ohms or 3 kilo ohms or 5 kilo ohms, so this 10 or 20 or 30 ohms can be neglected, 50 ohms can be neglected. And this ratio is typically close to 1. Or if you put the exact value, you'll find that this ratio is coming like only 0.98 or 0.99. So this is the relationship between Vin and Vs. Now we have to find out the output potential V naught. So what is the output potential? So as you see from this expression or from this diagram, that I naught is the current and the effective resistance is Re and R naught in shunt. So the output potential V naught can be represented like this. V naught can be represented like this, the current I naught multiplied with the effective, RE parallel R naught. This is the expression for the output voltage. RE parallel R naught. I naught is the current, which is nothing but 1 plus beta times IB. And what is the effective resistance over here? The effective resistance is given by RE parallel R naught. And if you want to find out the voltage differences, so there is another way to represent this one. So this is I naught. Suppose this current, which is flowing through this, is like I1, and this current which is flowing through this is I2. So you can find out what is the relationship between I1 and I0, and you can also multiply this I1 with RE. Ultimately, you'll be having the same expression. So V0 is equal to I0 into RE parallel R0. So which is equal to I0, as you know, 1 plus beta times IB into RE parallel R0. This is the expression for V0. So now, if you, I would like to find out the expression for the voltage gain, which is given by V0 upon Vs. So for V0, I can write 1 plus beta times IB into RE parallel R0. And for Vs, we can represent in terms of Vin first. So from this expression, 1 upon Vs is given by divided by Vin. So 1 upon Vs is given by Ri divided by Rs plus Ri. This is expression. Vs is given by Vin into Rs plus Ri divided by Ri. So Vin into Rs plus Ri divided by Ri. So now we can put the value for Vin in terms of IB. In terms of IB, we can put the value. So Vin is equal to, so in the numerator side, I can write the expression like this, 1 plus beta times IB into RE parallel R0 divided by Vin. Already we have this expression, IB R pi into 1 plus beta times IB RE parallel R0. So if I take IB outside, so this is nothing but R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE parallel R0 multiplied with RI by RI plus RS, which is simplified to, if I take IB cancel, if I make this IB part cancel from numerator and denominator, then we have 1 plus beta times RE parallel R0 upon R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE parallel R0 multiplied with this RI by RI plus RS. So looking at this particular formula, looking at this particular formula, we can see that this ratio RI by RI plus RS is very much close to 1, because RS is much, much small with respect to RI. But as long as RS is non-zero, this ratio cannot be equal to 1, but very close to 1. Now here, we have in the numerator 1 plus beta times RE parallel R0, which is typically very large, because that value is essentially governed by 1 plus beta times RE. Since RE is lower than R0, so in the parallel combination of RE and R0, will give a value very much close to RE. Somewhat less than RE, but close to RE. And essentially, this combination is governed by RE or controlled by RE. So 1 plus beta times RE in the numerator and the denominator we have r pi plus 1 plus beta times rd. Now, even if we compare this r pi and 1 plus beta times rd, then you'll see that r pi and rd, they are almost in the same order, in the order of kilo ohms. So therefore, in the numerator, you have 1 plus beta times rd, and in the denominator, you have r pi plus 1 plus beta times rd, where r pi is small as compared to 1 plus beta times rd. So eventually, this ratio is also very much close to 1. So ultimately, if I want to find out the final expression for the voltage gain for this particular type of amplifier, we'll see that we have two ratios where both of these two ratios are very much close to 1. It cannot be exactly equal to 1, but very much close to 1. And moreover, there is no such phase reversal, unlike common emitter configuration. So you might wonder that we are discussing about a common collector amplifier, and we are making the circuit, or we are regarding the circuit as an amplifier. And as far as your understanding in amplification is concerned, you know that whenever there is an amplifier, so obviously the input signal will be magnified by some means, by some value. Let it be 100, 200, 300, depending upon the requirement or depending upon the configuration. But here, ultimately, what you have seen is the voltage gain is coming very much close to 1. Sometimes it is less than 1, but it is close to 1. When you put the exact value, you'll find that the value of the voltage gain is coming like 0.9 to 0.95 within that range. But somewhat it is less than 1. So why we will regard this circuit as an amplifier, even if it doesn't amplify the signal? Or what is the requirement, what is the need of this type of amplifier, which does not amplify any signal? So I'm coming to this question later on of this discussion. Now, before that, let me go back to the previous slide and see here. Already we are talking about the common collector amplifier. So we have applied some signal over here, some Vs over here at this base terminal. And at the collector terminal, we find that the voltage gain is close to 1. So I am, for simplicity, I'm assuming that the voltage gain is equal to 1. And there is no phase reversal. So there is no phase reversal and there is no voltage gain. So whatever be the signal you apply over here, you're supposed to get the same signal at the output terminal. You are supposed to get the same signal at the output terminal with the same magnitude. I mean, if it is like 5 millivolt peak to peak, you'll be having the same 5 millivolt peak to peak with no phase reversal. So in other words, you'll see that this emitter terminal is basically following the potential at the base terminal. You are applying the signal, the small signal at the base terminal. And at the emitter terminal, you are essentially getting the same signal without any phase reversal, without any magnification. So that's why this particular circuit is also known as emitter follower circuit. So common collector is also known as emitter follower, because common collector circuit is also known as emitter follower circuit, because here the emitter terminal will follow the input signal. Emitter terminal will follow emitter terminal, which is nothing but the output terminal here. So this terminal follows the input signal available. So that's why this particular configuration is also known as common collector configuration. Now, before moving further, so already we have seen that the voltage gain provided by this type of amplifier is equal to 1. So let us check whether this type of amplifier provides any current gain or not. So for this, let me redraw the circuit once again to identify whether this circuit provides any current gain or not. And then we will investigate what is the use of this circuit. Now we have this one, this current source over here. We have so this is nothing but the parallel combination R between R1 and R2. This is R pi. This is RS, source resistance, VS. So this one is Vs. This one. So this is Gm times V pi. This is R naught. This is Rd. So we are taking the output from this terminal. So far we have calculated the voltage gain. It was coming close to 1. Now to find out the current gain, we have to identify what is input current and what is output current. So output current is through this terminal. So let this current be IE, the current that is flowing through the emitter terminal. Let this current be IE. And the input current is, so this is the amplifier circuit. This is the overall amplifier circuit. Now what is the current being fed by the signal source? Let this current is regarded as II. This current is regarded as II. Now we have to identify the current gain AI by means of this expression IE upon II. So output current is the emitter current that is flowing through RE, emitter resistance. And the input current is the current being drawn by the amplifier itself. Now, once again, let us try to identify these resistances. Looking at this terminal, the effective resistance was RIB. And looking at this terminal, the effective resistance was RI. And here, the total current is I naught. This total current I naught can be regarded as IB current that is flowing through this plus beta times IB current that is coming through this terminal. So the total current is like 1 plus beta times IB. So we can write this IE in terms of I naught. We can easily write down the expression for IE in terms of I naught. We have two parallel combination over here, R naught and RE. We have two parallel combination R naught and RE over here. So IE is represented by I naught upon, sorry, let me reframe this one. Let me reframe this one, this particular thing, because I think it will take more place. So we have I naught, the total current is given by 1 plus beta times IB. Now, this emitter current or the output current is given by I naught divided by R naught plus RE multiplied with R naught, which is quite obvious from the voltage divider rule. Because if the value of RE is more, in that case, most of the current will flow through R naught. And on the other hand, if the value of R naught is more, then most of the current will flow through RE. So that's why this is the standard rule. IE is given by I naught by R naught plus RE multiplied with RE. So if R naught is more, then IE will be more. Then what about the input current? How can we write the input current? Now, The input current is entering at this particular terminal, II. This current is entering at the base terminal. Now, there is a two branch. There are two branches. One is R1 parallel R2, and second one is this one, RIB. So looking at this terminal, the resistance, effective resistance, is nothing but RIB. So basically, if I once again redraw this one, so this is something like that. This is R1 parallel R2, and you have RIB over here. So the total current that is entering is II, for example, and the current that is flowing through this branch is IB. So similarly, I can also write IB in terms of II. So what is that? So we have R1 parallel R2 upon R1 parallel R2 plus RIB multiplied with II. So II is the total current. II is the total current. Then there is a branch. One is through R1 parallel R2, and second one is through this RIB, where RIB is the effective resistance looking at this terminal, looking at this point, without incorporating this R1 parallel R2. So IB is represented by R1 parallel R2 upon R1 parallel R2 plus RIB into II. So we need to find out the relationship between IE and II. So already we have calculated I is equal to 1 plus beta times IB. So everything has been represented in terms of IB. So putting those values, I'm writing IE as, so I naught can be represented like this, 1 plus beta times IB into, we have R0 upon R0 plus RE. This is the expression for IE. I0 has been represented by 1 plus beta times IB into this one, R0 by R0 plus RE. Divided by, we have II. So what is II? II is nothing but, II can be represented by this. So 1 upon II over here. So II, instead of writing II, what can I write over here is R1 parallel R2 divided by R1 parallel R2 plus RIB into 1 by IB. So IB gets cancelled. So we have 1 plus beta outside. In the numerator, we have R1 parallel R2 divided by R1 parallel R2 plus RIB into R0 upon R0 plus RD. Now this factor, R0 upon R0 plus RE, is close to 1, because R0 is much, much larger with respect to RE. So this factor is close to 1. And in case R1 parallel R2 is chosen to be much, much higher than RIB, so in that case, this particular factor is also equal to 1, or close to 1. So ultimately, we have this expression for the current gain, AI, is coming like approximately 1 plus beta, which is nothing but the current gain for the common collector amplifier. So this has been obtained from the mathematical illustration. Now you have to justify this calculation from your basic understanding. As you know, that for common collector amplifier, the input current is the base current and the output current is emitter current. And already you know that for any particular transistor, the base current and the emitter current, they follow that particular equation. IB multiplied with 1 plus beta is equal to your IE. That means emitter current is equal to 1 plus beta times the base current. So for the BJT itself, for the transistor itself, this base current and the emitter current, they follow this particular equation, 1 plus beta times IB is equal to IE. But whenever you incorporate this BJT into an amplifier, so in that case, the corresponding components of the amplifiers like R1, R2, RE, so there are different resistances which are used to bias the transistor. So they will also take part in controlling the output current or in controlling the current gain. So as a matter of fact, you will find that the output current by input current, that means the current gain, is a function of these defined elements. So out of these elements, there are a few elements coming from the biasing circuit, this R1, R2, and RE. And there are a few elements which are coming from the transistor itself, this RIB, if I just consider this R0, and if I consider this RPi, so they are coming within the transistor itself. If I just observe conceptually the operation of this particular circuit, where the input is the base current and the output is basically the emitter current. So you can intuitively say that between the input and output, there is a gain of current by an amount of 1 plus beta. But remember that this value of 1 plus beta is not true always unless and until we follow this approximation. If I do not allow that, or if I do not assume that R1 parallel R2 is much greater than RIB and R0 is much greater than RE. So under these conditions only, under these assumptions only, you'll find that the current gain is equal to 1 plus beta. Otherwise, it will be less than 1 plus beta. Even if this R1 parallel R2 is comparable with RIB, then also you'll see that it is less than 1 plus beta. It is not equal to 1 plus beta. But with some approximation, with some extreme condition, I can find that the current gain is equal to 1 plus beta. So we have seen that for common collector amplifier, the voltage gain is equal to 1. Basically, it is less than 1, but max to max, it could have been 1. It cannot be higher than 1. And similarly, for the current gain, it can be at most 1 plus beta. So the next question is that what is the utility of this particular thing, this common collector amplifier, to use as a voltage amplifier, because there is no voltage gain available from our analysis. Now, for this purpose, let us take a look at the impedances provided by this common collector configuration. So as you know, for common emitter configuration, the input impedance was essentially governed by RPi, the resistance which is connected between base to emitter. And here you will find that the input impedance looking at the base is given by RIB, which is equal to this RIB. In the last slide, we have already calculated this RIB is eventually given by RPi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So this is much larger as compared to RPi because of the magnification by this 1 plus beta factor. So as a matter of fact, the common collector configuration is having a very high value of input impedance. That is the one advantageous part. So as you know, whenever we would like to amplify any signal, for example, let me clarify over here. Suppose you have, for any signal, suppose you have signal source over here, suppose there is a voltage source with a corresponding source resistance RS, and suppose the amplifier is having an input impedance of, say, Rm. So this is nothing but the input impedance of the amplifier. So you are connecting the signal source Vs to the amplifier itself, and the amplifier is providing an input impedance of Rm. So as a matter of fact, the signal that is coupled at the input side of the amplifier, so basically there is an amplifier over here, there is a black box over here, there is a black box over here. There is a black box over here, and the input provided by the signal source is Vs, and the input that is getting coupled to the amplifier is, say, this is Vamp, for example, Vamp. So as you understand, that because of the presence of the source resistance, this Vs and Vamp, they normally they are not close to each other. So if I just follow this voltage divider rule, we can easily find out that Vamp, the signal that is basically coupled to the amplifier itself, is given by Vs upon Rs plus Rm multiplied with Rm. Now, in case when the value of Rm itself is very large with respect to Rs, so in that case, you will see that almost all the, I mean, the entire input signal will be coupled to the input side of the amplifier. Otherwise, there will be coupling loss, severe coupling loss. For example, if I select Rs to be like, say, let it be like 100 ohms. And suppose, let us consider Rm to be 1 kilo ohms in one case, for common emitter, for example, and Rm for common collector, let it be 1000 kilo ohms, that means 1 mega ohms. So let us try to find out the ratio. This ratio, this coupling factor, Rm by Rs plus Rm, what is the ratio? So for common emitter, you'll see that you have 1 kilo ohm, that means 1000 over here in the numerator, divided by 1100. 1000 by 1100. So it is like 10 by 11. 10 by 11. So it's close to 0.97 or 0.98 if you just calculate this one. 10 by 11 C for common emitter configuration. Whereas for common collector, the numerator side, if R amp is 1000 kilo ohms, so I can write like 3, 4, 5, 6 upon 10,000 by 10,001. So obviously, you understand that for common emitter configuration, the ratio is lesser as compared to the common collector configuration. So the bottom line is that whenever you have a voltage amplifier kind of thing, and you have a signal source as a voltage source having some non-zero source resistance, so whenever you connect the signal source to an amplifier, then obviously our objective will be to increase the input impedance of the amplifier. So for common emitter configuration, you have seen that the input impedance is in the order of few kilo ohms, 5 kilo ohms, 8 kilo ohms, like this. Whereas for common collector amplifier, this input impedance has been raised, and it is almost in the order of, say, 150 kilo ohms, 200 kilo ohms, even higher, in the order of hundreds of kilo ohms, because of this 1 plus beta factor. So for voltage amplification, this particular amplifier will be of great use. And normally, we will be using this common collector amplifier at the last stage of any multi-stage amplifier before feeding the signal to a power amplifier section. So we'll be discussing this one in much more detail while we will consider the power amplifier in our syllabus. Now, so the input impedance is large for common collector, which is a very wonderful attribute as far as the voltage amplifier is concerned. And secondly, we would like to find out the output impedance. So that is also important. So whenever you feed the signal to some load, so obviously it is expected that the output impedance of that particular amplifier should be as small as possible, so that most of the voltage, most of the signal gets coupled to the load itself. So for common emitter amplifier, you have already seen that the input impedance is controlled by Rpi, and the output impedance is essentially controlled by the collector resistance or the output resistance or load resistance, Rc. Now for common collector amplifier, you have seen that the input impedance is essentially governed by Rpi plus 1 plus beta times Re. So this is much, much higher as compared to the common emitter configuration. Now let us have a look. Let us try to calculate the output impedance for common collector configuration. So to start with, once again, let me draw the basic small signal circuit. Otherwise, it will not be possible for us to develop the output impedance. So this is the circuit diagram. We have VS over here, the signal source. We have RS. We have R1 parallel R2. Here we have Rπ. Here we have GM times Vπ. Then you have R0, we have RE. Now to calculate the output impedance, what is done? You have to make the input signal inactive and you have to apply some external signal over here, some VX you are connecting over here. And suppose the current being drawn is IX. So the output resistance of the amplifier, looking at this terminal, it will be R0. So R0 is given by Vx by Ix. So this is done when the input signal is inactive, when the input signal is absent. Because if you just consider the H parameter model, we have two equations like this. V1 is equal to H11I1 plus H12V2. Once again, let me refer to this one, this H parameter model, V1. Is equal to H11I1 plus H12V2. And I2 is equal to H21I1 plus H22V2. So basically, we are representing the input signal at the port 1 and the output signal at port 2. That means the input voltage at port 1 and output current at port 2. These are the two dependent variables, and we are representing them in terms of the input current at port 1 and output voltage at port 2. So in order to find out the output impedance, which is nothing but the ratio between I2 and V2, or the reverse of the ratio I2 by V2, so this is done keeping I1 is equal to 0. So I2 by V2, so in order to calculate H22, the expression was H22 is given by I2 by V2 with I1 is equal to 0. That means the input signal must be 0. So here we have two different possibility. So let us assume that when VS is equal to 0, the input signal is equal to 0. At the same time, I'm assuming that this signal source resistance is also 0. Eventually, this circuit can be redrawn like this. This circuit is redrawn like this. So input is absent. In order to calculate the output impedance, we are providing some externally connected signal, Vx. Because if there is no input, how can we get the output? So that's why we are externally connecting one signal, Vx over here. And suppose the current being drawn by the circuit itself is Ix. So this ratio Vx upon Ix will give you the output impedance. Now here, this is R1 parallel R2. This one is Rπ. This one is GM times Vπ or beta times IB. Same thing. This is R0, this is RE. Now the signal source was absent, so that's why this is basically short circuited. Since we have a voltage source over here, so it is short circuited. Now see, between R1 parallel R2 and between this point, between this base point and ground, there is one resistance R1 parallel R2. There is another resistance which is zero, short circuited. So effectively, this terminal is also at zero potential because we have two resistances connected in shunt. And out of these two resistances, one resistance is having value of 0 ohms because it is short circuited. So eventually this potential is connected to ground, this potential, this point. Now, this is basically the base terminal. Here we have this terminal as the emitter terminal. This is the collector terminal. Collector is essentially connected to ground, a common collector configuration. Now we have already defined this resistance, this voltage drop is equal to Vpi. Vpi is nothing but the voltage drop across this Rpi resistance, considering the potential at the base terminal with respect to the emitter terminal. Now take a look at the relationship between this Vx and Vpi. Now here, already for the analysis of this output resistance, we have seen that this base terminal is connected to ground because this is short circuited. Through this path, this is already connected to AC ground. So Vpi and Vx, they follow this relation. Vpi is equal to minus Vx because Vx is nothing but the potential at this point emitter with respect to ground. And here, Vpi is nothing but the potential at the base with respect to emitter. Since base is already connected to ground, so it is quite trivial that Vpi is equal to minus Vx. Now, if I want to apply KVL, then we find that at this particular point, what are the current which are entering? Let me take some different color. At this particular point, at this emitter node, the total current that is entering is, one is through this path Ix, and second component is Gm times Vpi, which is entering, Gm times Vpi. So as far as the KCL is concerned, this total current that is leaving the terminal and the current that is entering the terminal must be the same. Let me use this part. Yes, now it is fine. So Ix plus Gm Vpi is equal to, what is the total current that is leaving the terminal? So here we have this terminal is having a potential of Vx. So we have two resistances. So I should write Vx upon Re plus Vx upon R naught and plus Vx upon R pi. So this potential is Vx. This is at ground. So here at this particular point, we have three different resistances connected in shunt. One is R pi, one is R naught, and the other one is Re. Potential at this point is Vx. So Vx upon R naught plus Vx upon Re plus Vx upon R pi is equal to the total current that is entering, which is nothing but Ix plus Gm times Vpi. So we can write Ix is equal to minus Gm Vpi, which is nothing but Gm times Vx, because Vx is equal to minus Vpi, plus Vx upon Re plus Vx upon R naught plus Vx upon R pi. So from this, we can deduce Ix upon Vx, which is nothing but 1 upon R naught, 1 upon the output resistance, is given by Gm plus 1 upon R pi plus 1 upon Re plus 1 upon R naught. So if I combine the first and second terms over here, you will find that we have 1 plus gm r pi over here in the numerator, plus we have 1 upon re plus 1 upon r naught. So 1 plus gm r pi, so as you know, gm r pi is nothing but the beta. So we have 1 plus beta times over here, 1 plus beta divided by r pi plus 1 upon re plus 1 upon r naught. So here we find that 1 by r naught, that means the inverse of the output impedance is equal to the inverse of three different resistances. So from your knowledge on Ohm's law, we can easily deduce that r naught is nothing but, since their inverses are connected together, since their inverses are added together, so the effective impedance is nothing but the parallel combination, parallel RE, parallel R naught. So these three resistances, R pi by 1 plus beta, RE and R naught, they are connected in shunt, so their effective equivalent resistance will be 1 plus beta by R pi plus 1 upon RE plus 1 upon R naught. So that will be called 1 upon R naught. So we have two R naught over here, this small R naught coming from the transistor itself, the output resistance of the transistor, and this is the output resistance of the common collector amplifier. So don't get confused with these two R naught. Small R naught is nothing but the output resistance of the amplifier itself, BJT itself, because of the change in the output current, due to the change in the output voltage that is coming from the concept of early voltage, this small R naught. And this capital R naught is nothing but the output volt, output impedance resulting from the circuit itself, common collector circuit itself. So considering this, we have three parallel combination, I mean three resistances connected in shunt. So as you know, whenever we have three resistances connected in shunt, so the effective resistance is basically governed by the lowest of three, unless they are in the same order. So as you understand, they are obviously not in the same order. RE, this emitter resistance, they are in the order of few kilo ohms, which is acting as the output resistance over here for this common collector configuration. R naught, which is typically very large, in the order of few hundreds of kilo ohms or even larger. And R pi by 1 plus beta, this is typically very small because R pi is in the order of kilo ohms and divided by 1 plus beta is there. So if I just put the value, like R pi equal to 5 kilo ohms and beta is equal to 100, then it is coming like 5000 by 100, so only 50 ohms. So out of these three resistances, R pi by 1 plus beta, RE and R naught, the least is R pi by 1 plus beta. So effectively, this output impedance or output resistance is governed by R pi by 1 plus beta, because this is the lowest value out of these three. They have orders of differences. One is in the order of few tens of ohms. This one is in the order of few, this value is in the order of few tens of ohms, R pi by 1 plus beta. RE is in the order of few kilo ohms, and R naught is in the order of few hundreds of kilo ohms. So had we have considered that these three resistances are connected in series, so in that case, the output effective resistance will be governed by the highest out of these three. Now, since they are connected in shunt path, so effective resistance will be governed by the lowest out of these three. So lowest value is R pi by 1 plus beta. So that's why R naught is given by R pi by 1 plus beta, and which could have been further approximated to R pi by beta only, because since beta is very large with respect to 1, so I can safely write R pi by beta, and which is nothing but 1 upon gm, because beta is equal to gm times R pi, so 1 upon gm. So eventually, for common collector configuration, the output impedance is given by R pi by beta, and the value is very small, in the order of few tens of ohms, but typical R pi of 5 kilo ohms. So if I select R pi to be at 5 kilo ohms, R pi 5 kilo ohms, typically, with beta 100, so 5000 by 100. So it will be like 50 ohms only. So what we have seen, this common collector configuration is providing two essential advantages. So it doesn't amplify any signal. It doesn't amplify any voltage signal. The voltage gain is remaining the same, almost the same. Even sometimes it is less than one. But two important advantages it provides. So while discussing the basic attributes of an amplifier, we have mentioned that apart from the voltage gain and apart from the bandwidth, which we will be discussing in the next module, there are two different attributes as well, important attributes. One is the input impedance, second one is the output impedance. So for a voltage amplifier, in addition to providing a very high gain value, very high value of voltage gain, it is also expected that the input impedance provided by the voltage amplifier should be as high as possible. And at the same time, the output impedance provided by the circuit should be as small as possible. And the bandwidth, which we have not discussed so far, but for the timing, I can tell you that it is expected from our side, from the circuit designer's perspective, that the bandwidth of any amplifier should be as high as possible, as large as possible. But being a circuit designer, you cannot achieve all these objectives simultaneously. If you want to accomplish one objective, the other objective will be compromised to some extent. So here for common collector amplifier, I'm not considering the bandwidth yet, but as far as the voltage gain and the input and output impedances are concerned, we have seen that this input impedance is pretty large and the output impedance is pretty small, which are two essential requirements for any voltage amplifier. However, for this common collector configuration, we don't have sufficient amount of voltage gain. Although there is a current gain, resulting from the circuit. And while discussing the bandwidth attributes of any small signal amplifier, we will try to understand what is the performance of this common collector configuration as far as the bandwidth is concerned. So normally, this common collector configuration, since it doesn't provide any additional gain, so normally it is used as the last unit of any multi-stage amplifier, so that these impedances, these impedance mismatches can be taken care of, and we can provide the maximum signal available to us to the load circuit, and we can extract the maximum signal from the signal source itself. So I think with this, I can conclude today's discussion on common collector configuration.